Let's look into confidence intervals for the population mean mu using the T procedure. I am going to assume that you've already been introduced to the notion of confidence intervals for the population mean, and I look at that introduction in other videos. For the methods used in this video to be reasonable, we require, first of all, a simple random sample from the population of interest, and it's always important that we have a good sampling design. And we also require a normally distributed population. But the assumption of a normally distributed population will not be important if we have a large sample size. If these assumptions are reasonable, then there are two possible paths, depending on whether the population standard deviation sigma is known. We've previously been introduced to the notion that if the population standard deviation sigma is known, which would be rare in practice, then the confidence interval is made up of the sample mean plus and minus this margin of error. This quantity given here is sometimes labeled with the notation sigma subscript x bar, and that quantity is the true standard deviation of the sampling distribution of x bar. And if the population standard deviation sigma is known, then we find this z value from the standard normal distribution. But it is very rare that the population standard deviation sigma is known, and we typically estimate sigma with S, the sample standard deviation. This quantity here is sometimes referred to as the standard error of X bar. The standard error of X bar is S over the square root of N, and that is the estimated standard deviation of the sampling distribution of X bar. And so if we are using the sample standard deviation to estimate the population standard deviation, this is going to be our margin of error, where this t value is found from the t distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. Let's take a look at that in a little more detail. If we are sampling from a normally distributed population where we do not know the value of sigma, then this is the appropriate formula for the confidence interval. 1 minus alpha times 100% is our confidence level, and the most common choice of confidence level is 95%, which would mean that the alpha level is 0.05. But we can choose other confidence levels if we so desire, like 90% or anything we want. We choose it, so we could choose it to be 31.4% if we so desired. Our choice of confidence level is tied in with the t value that we use. And this comes from a t distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom, and I've drawn that in here. If we want the confidence level to be 1 minus alpha times 100%, then we put an area of 1 minus alpha in the middle. And the remaining area is alpha. And so we split that evenly into the two tails, and put an area of alpha over 2 in the left tail, and an area of alpha over 2 in the right tail. T sub alpha over 2 is notation. It is notation for the t value with an area to the right of alpha over 2. I take a look at an introduction to the t distribution in greater detail in other videos, but let's have a quick look here. Here the white curve represents the standard normal distribution, and the red curve represents the t-distribution with 2 degrees of freedom. Like the standard normal distribution, the t-distribution is symmetric about zero and bell-shaped, but the t-distribution has heavier tails, in other words, greater area in the tails, and a lower peak. The precise shape of the t-distribution depends on these degrees of freedom, which are related to the sample size. And as the degrees of freedom increase, we'll see this t distribution tend towards the standard normal. Here's a t distribution with 5 degrees of freedom, getting a little closer to the standard normal, with 10, with 15, and with 20 degrees of freedom. Here it's looking quite close to the standard normal distribution, but if we look carefully, we can see that it still has slightly heavier tails, and it still has a slightly lower peak. Let's look at an example of calculating and interpreting a confidence interval using the T procedure. A cereal producer makes cereal boxes with a stated weight of 750 grams. From a large lot of these boxes, a random sample of 7 boxes yielded a sample mean of 795.3 grams and a sample standard deviation of 17.8 grams. And suppose we wish to construct a 95% confidence interval for mu, the true mean weight of boxes in this lot. Here we do not know the population standard deviation sigma, and S represents the sample standard deviation S. And since our standard deviation is based on sample data, we're going to use the T procedure and not the Z procedure. The T procedure assumes that we have a normally distributed population, and we should always investigate that assumption before carrying out the procedure. Here's a normal quantile-quantile plot of the weights in the 7 boxes of cereal. If you recall, a normal quantile-quantile plot will be an approximately straight line if the data is approximately normally distributed. And I would say that these 7 points lie in an approximately straight line. So I would say that it's okay to go ahead and use our T procedures here. We've at least gone through and investigated the normality assumption. We don't see any glaring deviations from normality, but it's always a little bit sketchy using the procedures for such a small sample size. Here, once again, is our confidence interval formula. And the information that we've been given previously, the sample mean, the sample standard deviation, and the sample size. Now we need to find this T sub alpha over 2 value. And that comes from a T distribution with n minus 1 degrees of freedom. And so I've plotted in here a T distribution with 6 degrees of freedom. We want a 95% confidence level, which means the alpha level is 5%, or 0.05. And what we do is we put 95% of the area in the middle of the distribution here. 95% of the area in the middle, and the remaining area, 0.05, we split evenly into the two tails. So we're going to put an area of 0.025 in the right tail, and an area of 0.025 in the left tail. The value we need for our confidence interval is right here. And for that, we're going to need to go to software or a t-table. And if we go to software or a t-table, we can find that that value is 2.447. And notation-wise, we call that value t sub 0.025, the t value with an area of 0.025 off to the right. Now we have everything that we need to calculate our confidence interval. Our confidence interval is the value of the sample mean, 795.3, plus and minus the t-value we just found of 2.447, times the sample standard deviation of 17.8 over the square root of the sample size. And this works out to the sample mean plus and minus 16.46. 16.46 is our 95% margin of error. And if I carry out the addition and subtraction, and let's say I round to one decimal place, I get a lower bound of my confidence interval of 778.8 and an upper bound of 811.8. And as always, the interpretation of a confidence interval is very important. Here we are saying we are 95% confident that the population mean mu lies somewhere within that interval. But what does that mean in the context of this problem? It means that we can be 95% confident that the true mean weight of cereal in boxes from this lot lies between 778.8 and 811.8 grams. A couple of notes to finish. This analysis does give a hint about the weight of cereal boxes of this type in general, but statistically our conclusions apply only to this lot. Our statistical conclusions apply only to the population from which we drew our sample. And it is questionable to use these T procedures for such a small sample size. Here we only had 7 observations. And when we have a small sample size like this, the performance of the T procedures is heavily reliant on the normality assumption. Here we did investigate the normality assumption with a normal quantile-quantile plot, but we would feel a lot better about using these procedures if we had a larger sample size.